Well, thank you very much for the introduction. First of all, I would like to thank IFPRI for inviting me to Washington and to enable me to share with you our vision for food security in the newest country in the world, in South Sudan. I would also like to thank all of you for taking your valuable time to come and listen to me. I hope after my presentation, I will have all the good suggestions from you researchers, policymakers, policy analysts, so that I take back home with me all the good ideas from here. This is a strategy we call the newest path, because we have to walk the path and walk the route other peoples have walked, avoid the thorns they stepped on, but gain from their experiences. Today, I would be presenting to you, first of all, the objectives, why am I here at all? And then I will introduce to you agriculture in South Sudan. What are the important facts about South Sudan? What are the agricultural potential? The trends and challenges of agriculture in South Sudan? What is the vision and mission of the Ministry of Agriculture in South Sudan? And then our path forward, the targets and guiding principles, a national strategy for growth, other key government actors in food security, and an update on actions and possible partnerships we are looking for, policy actions, boosting investment in agriculture, areas of possible partnership, and I would want to hear feedback and discussions from you. So the objectives here is one, to introduce South Sudan, because when you were asked who knows which one is the newest country, I didn't see a hand up. But I'm sure most of you or all of you know the newest country in the world. And I will also present both the potentials and challenges facing South Sudan's agricultural sector, examine the trends and causes behind South Sudan's struggle with achieving food security, outline our emerging plans for agricultural transformation, and encourage partnership with the multilateral, bilateral, and private sector stakeholders for investment and grants. This is the Sudan you knew, the bigger Sudan. And if you see, I don't know, does it have a highlighter, a pointer?
Yes, one.
Yeah, let me try. Okay, you can see the white line there. That is where South Sudan broke off from the main Sudan. It became independent on the 9th of July 2011, that is a year and 3 months ago, after years of conflict with South Sudan, I mean with the Sudan in general. And this independence did not come on a silver plate. After the comprehensive peace agreement, South Sudan was given 6 years to have a trial whether they would really want to unite and live as one country, or the South would choose to separate. Then in January 2011, a referendum was held, and the margin of error is very small, 99.5 we say, people of South Sudan voted for separation. It's a huge number, isn't it? I don't think it has ever happened in any country, in any referendum, that people would, with one heart, vote that enough is enough. So South Sudanese voted. Then 6 months later, in July the 9th, the government of the Republic of South Sudan was formed. And we were pleased that the president of the Sudan, Omar al-Bashir, came down and said, "I accept the result of the referendum, so South Sudan can get its independence." That was a first step and was very important. The land area given to South Sudan is 650 approximately, could be more because there are contested areas in Sudan that we are in Sudan and South Sudan that we are not counting, but approximately what we have safely now is 650,000 square kilometers. The population, as estimated in the census of 2008, is 8.26 million, but we know that the population is more than that. And also with the returns, the current population could be 10 to 11 million people. But if you compare the land mass and the population, there's very low population density, about 13 people per square kilometer. So there's a lot of space not utilized. And the population growth is now estimated at the rate of 3%. What are the agricultural potentials in South Sudan? South Sudan has 7 distinct rural zones. Those colors, blue, yellow, green, all showed very different livelihood zones. The very dark part of it, at the bottom, the green one is what we call the green zone. And then you have the iron plateau zone. But these are 7 distinct zones, or livelihood zones of South Sudan. The farming systems are mostly small scale, subsistence, and traditional. Small scale in a sense that we still cultivate like 0.5 acres of land and people live on it. And traditional, because we are still using just the hand tools. We haven't moved from there. But there's a strong opportunity in South Sudan. We have potential of 95% of South Sudan's of the 650,000 kilometers square is suitable for agriculture. Of these, 50% is prime agricultural land, with soils and climates suitable for a wide variety of food and cash crops. We see in South Sudan that if you plant a piece of nail, it can grow into a crop or a tree. So it is very prime. However, only 4% of this prime land is under cultivation, and mostly it is rain-fed. 29% of the land is under forest cover, very rich in timber and non-timber resources, and some of these timber are planted timber like teak, some are natural timbers like mahogany. 80% of the population in South Sudan is rural. We still are trying to maintain them, not to migrate to the urban. With 45% of those rural population is agro-pastoralist, 35% are agrarian, 12% are fishermen, 8% are others, whether they work for the government, they work for other jobs, or they hunt for their living. South Sudan has the 6th biggest herd in Africa. 11.7% of it is cattle, 12.3 million sheep, heads of sheep, and 12.6 million head of goats. We don't count the chickens because every household have minimum of 5 chickens. And a national herd structure is 70% female. This can tell you 70% female means there's a very high potential of increase in livestock in South Sudan. There's abundant water sources. There are many rivers. If you look at Sudan, it is all scattered with rivers and tributaries. And the Nile, by the way, passes through South Sudan, and it contributes to the water resources of South Sudan. There's high rainfall running 9 months a year, and an average rainfall ranges from 500 millimeters to 2,000 millimeters per year. There's only one small bit of South Sudan that is a bit dry, and it has only about this area. That is where the rainfall is low. The rest of South Sudan receives very high rainfall. Green Belt, which you saw before here, receives about 2,000 millimeters of rain a year. So they're very, very high rainfall, and it goes for 9 months of the year. This gives you the potential of what crops we can grow and how long and how many cycles of crop can be grown. There's high potential for irrigated agriculture because of the many rivers and the tributaries that are there. At present, less than 3% of cultivated land is irrigated. And the irrigated land actually only mostly are in the northern part of South Sudan, where the government of Sudan at the time utilized the land for irrigated agriculture in order to supply surplus cereals to the Sudan. And there is very high potential for rice and other water-intensive crops. With such a land, you would understand that the potential for rice production is very high. But another resource which we are not utilizing properly is the fish. With the Nile River, and there's a lake, if I go back to this one, you know, this deep water, this deep area here, has a lake where if you are in the middle of this lake, you see nowhere. So at one time, people named it Lake No because it is nowhere. So it is Lake No. It has very huge potential for fish. But South Sudan production gap has been rising in the recent years. This is a graph that shows the production, the gross production, then the net production. The deep blue is the gross production. The light blue is the net production. This is because after the production during the harvest, there's a very high loss in post-harvest. So the net productions become lower than the gross production. We don't utilize all of that is get from there. And yet the level of demand is higher than the production. South Sudan faces many challenges in achieving a successful agricultural transformation. There are many different reasons, including the few I'm going to name, but not limited to them. One of them is inadequate capacity in terms of low human capacity for policy formulation, implementation, and evaluation, including management and execution. And you know, during this long period of war, many people of South Sudan origin, they took refuge either to the neighboring countries, some came as far as America, some went to other countries. Many of them got education, but they have not returned. Those who have returned have various capacities, human capacity. So South Sudan still have very low human capacity. There's lack of institutional capacity to implement food security programs. For example, crop forecasting, we rarely know about it. If you go walk into the Ministry of Agriculture and start talking to an official and said, how do you forecast? What is your crop forecast? He will say, what are you talking about? This is because we still need to update and build the capacity. Early warning systems, disaster management, still the capacity is very low. We also have very poor infrastructure. Road linkages to all the states of South Sudan is still very poor. There are some roads, most of them are gravel roads, which were built in the old days, and they have not been maintained. And crossing some of these places during the rainy season is a nightmare and may not be there. So road is one hurdle we have in South Sudan, and especially in improving food security. Because even if you have a lot of food in one area, moving it to another area is very difficult. Market accessibility is a problem. Marketing itself is also a problem. Storage, we still use the traditional gugus with very poor storage. So losses are very high during storage as well. We have very weak research capacity, extremely weak. The ability to conduct basic research on technology development, adaptation, and dissemination, leading to limited access to agricultural technology and input is very, very low. We have, within the ministry, we have a small unit for research. We have universities that also do a little bit of research, but the capacity is very, 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 very low. We have inefficient farming practices. We are still using the hoes. I think in the US, these hoes are already in the archives or in museums. But for us, these are still very valuable instruments we are using. Our post-harvest losses, I said before, is very high because the handling is poor. Sometimes our things get ripened during the rainy season. For example, we grow maize in the green belt 3 times a year. The first maize will ripen and mature at the time the rain is extremely high. So the farmer struggles between harvesting and drying the maize properly and weeding and planting another crop. So the post-harvest losses is very high. Storage availability is another one, I've already said. And then because we don't have irrigation practices, we still depend on rain-fed agriculture. If the rain fails, our agriculture fails. Private sector investment in agriculture is very low. We have only the national people who try to do some investment in agriculture. I don't know why we have failed to attract people to come to this highly productive country. But the investment in agriculture from the private sector is very, very, very low. So it means South Sudan is still dependent on the government budget to move its agriculture. And this very young country with competing needs means the government will not be able to satisfy the budget needs of the Ministry of Agriculture or the ministries that are moving agricultural challenges. There are other issues that compound the challenges. Number one, erratic rainfall. We depend on the rainfall for our agriculture. For example, in the year 2011, there was drought, so crops failed. This year, 2012, there's too much rain, so areas got flooded, and some of the crops stood in water and they died, they didn't mature. There are areas that are prone to this, the drought in eastern Equatoria, the flooding in Jonglei and northern Bargazal states. This led to 25% lower cereal harvest in 2011, and we think in 2012 it will also be between 20 to 25% lower than the other 5 years before. But we also had internal conflicts in Jonglei state. This is a state, OH, Jonglei state is this one here. This is a state where the majority of the people live on livestock. They are livestock herders. So the livestock is becoming a pride that everybody wants to own. But unfortunately, they start fighting over livestock ownership because they begin to steal from each other. And to them, taking from another is not a crime. It's a tradition that if you are a man, especially the young growing youth, you must go and steal some cattle to show your manhood. So it is not a crime. However, with you know, with these so many small arms in the hand of people, it turned bloody, because the other youth would try to go and get back their cattle. So on the way they clash, so it turned bloody, it displaced people, so it disrupted livestock movement and disrupted crop production and access to market. We also have returnees struggling to resettle and to farm. Because many people who are coming back, they are starting from scratch. Their homes were burnt during the war, so they have to start building their homestead in order to live and also cultivate at the same time. So they struggle to build a place to put their children and at the same time catch up with the rain in order to cultivate. So this also is a challenge that we have been seeing. Close to 1.6 million people return. A lot of them returned from the north. This year alone, the year 2012, we brought back nearly 1 million people from the north, and the others are voluntary returns and from other areas, Uganda, Kenya, Ethiopia. And then we have economic challenges, which is hurting ability to purchase food. One, the Republic of South Sudan found itself suddenly a country, and it had oil resources. So it said, okay, we have money, we can start using the oil resource. Then when the problem between Khartoum and the South intensified, the oil was shut down, the government tried its best to maintain the market. But you know, people started saying, oh, there's no dollar in the market. Everything started going up and the purchasing power of the people was reduced. This also caused a bit of food insecurity in some areas and inflation as well. But the government has done its best to maintain the situation and also support the traders who are bringing in food from outside, because just 1 year the country has not cultivated enough to meet its demand. But there is continued unrest between Khartoum and the northern border of South Sudan, these dotted lines if you see. This area is the Abyei area. If you have heard of it in the news, Abyei is still a very contested area. And then this area is also very contested because this is where Ejiliji is, where the oil the resources, and Khartoum wants to get hold of it, but that is part of the south. So this continuous unrest at the borders, which is causing also the people at the border of South Sudan moving down, becoming refugee, internally displaced refugee. But that is not all, because Khartoum is also having fight with the community of Kordofan, Blue Nile, and Darfur. This is also pushing these people because they cannot go into other areas. South Sudan becomes the nearest country for them to take refugee. So there's a high influx of refugees to these areas, causing also already pressure on the food we have. Then what is the vision and mission of the ministry? The vision is that there should be food security for all the people of the Republic of South Sudan to enjoy improved quality of life, environment, and economic prosperity. And the mission is to create an enabling environment for transformation of agriculture into a modern, market-oriented, and economical sustainable system. So this is the vision and the mission. The agricultural sector policy targets and guiding principles for the year 2012 to 2017, 5 years. The overall objective is food security for all the people of South Sudan. The targets are a more than double cereal production from the 700,000 metric tons now to 1.5 metric tons per year. Cropland to increase from 3.8% of cultivation that is now under cultivation to 14%. This is very ambitious because this is like four folds. Per capita cropland from 0.3 to 0.99 hectares. Annual increase of more than 20% for roots and tubers. We have so many different types of roots and tubers that can actually cushion in the food security. The cassava, the Irish potatoes, the sweet potatoes, these can also cushion in as a backlog for the food security. And increase average yield of cereals. When we talk of cereals in South Sudan, we talk mainly of maize in the equatorial states, the three equatorial states, and sorghum for the rest of the country. We have a bit of rice, which is the third cereal grown also in South Sudan. And we are hoping that when we do these three targets, the above targets, it will reduce the rural poverty by 20%. It's very ambitious, but we are hoping that we can, together with our partners, move this to 20% from the baseline level of 55.4% at the moment. What would be the guiding principles for us to do this? To create conducive policies for agricultural growth, and we are doing this already with the government, a policy of low inflation, a stable exchange rates, and favorable trade and market environment. You would be pleased to know that even when the oil was shut down for the last 9 months, the official dollar rate in of South Sudan did not go down. It remained at 2.99. The black market inflated, but the official one remained, and the government tried its best to put money into the market to stabilize the market. So this is one of the policies of the government, to reduce the inflation so that food prices don't go up so high. Also, the government decentralizes its system of service delivery. Instead of the center doing everything, there are three levels of governance in South Sudan. There's the national government, there's the state government, and then there's the county, the local government. So with the decentralized system, there are different levels of doing things. This will also help the participatory development of the people right from the grassroots up to the national level. And the all-inclusive extension approach, meaning everybody who is participating in food security efforts should work together, should be inclusive. instead of the government doing one thing, donor agencies doing another, or NGOs doing another. It should be all inclusive and working to complement each other. And the promotion of the PPPs, the public-private partnerships, the government is really promoting this, because government cannot by itself improve the food security just by itself as a government. And a private sector would also need the government to work together, because there are certain things that the government can move. And then in partnership, we feel that it will work better and work very well. Mobilization of cooperatives and farmer-based organizations. Since we are still very subsistent, we cannot start very big. We cannot jump start, and we cannot leap like a frog. We have to leap step by step. So we have to pull along with us the farmer-based organizations and transform them into cooperatives in a more organized manner, so that they also are included in the sustainable agricultural production. Promoting value addition and processing is very important. It may also reduce the losses that we see in our post-harvest handling. Things like maize don't last very long if they are grains, but if they are processed into flours, they add value and they stay longer. Strengthening rural infrastructure, especially the roads, connecting farmers is very important. Connecting farmers to the market is crucial. So if you want to increase productivity beyond subsistence, it means you have to find a way that they can access markets, and roads are one of the most important developments that the South need to put in place. Managing and protecting forest resources, 29% of the landmass of South Sudan is forest. We could say, let's clear all the forests and increase productivity, then we have the problem of climatic change. So we need to manage this forest resource very well. So we are working very much with the other ministries, especially Ministry of Environment, because this is situated in a different ministry, to see how we can manage the forest resources. And then the government actually should not be the one implementing all this, but should be the one drumming, making the drum for the songs, and other people dance the dance. So what is our growth strategy? One, we want to emphasize on agricultural policies. Because if we have a policy, clear policy, then we know where we are going. We know where we are now, but we need to know where we are going and how do we go there. So identifying and prioritizing policies that quickly produce agricultural production is very, very important to us. And then development of rural infrastructure. Improve access to markets and other rural infrastructure through rehabilitation and expansion of rural infrastructure, including feeder roads, storage facilities, and markets. These are crucial. And then building storage facilities and training in post-harvest handling would also improve food security, because it will reduce the losses that we see during post-harvest handling. Encourage market-led private sector participation in agriculture. We want the private sector to be active in the agricultural production. The government cannot do it. The government cannot do it alone. Private sector should really come in more to help in the participation. In this way, the government wants to mobilize, organize, and support farmers, entrepreneurs, and investors. One of these talks we do around the world is to really mobilize you to come to South Sudan and also join the hand in the private sector participation. To build a stronger enabling environment for investment. I hear a lot of people are saying we don't know where to go, investment opportunity is there, but how do we start? The government is now putting in place investment programs, investment hub, one shop, stop shop. If you go, then you just go and do everything in one area instead of being directed, go to that ministry or go to that minister or go to that. It is now being organized for investors so that they find it easy. Because this is one of the enabling environment that we are trying to do. And we also want to strengthen cooperatives and farmers group, because we know together they can move rather than individually. National capacity strengthening. the focus on capacity building at the central, that is the national level, and then the state and the country public officials is very important, because if we want to analyze policy or write policy and we have officials that are not strong enough, we will not be able to do it. So it's important to capacity build. I said before, our human capacity is very, very low. We need to strengthen it. And also to continue supporting private sector enterprise development. The other thing that is very important to farmers is the credit facilities. With subsistence farming, with having no collaterals, the farmers in South Sudan are not able to get credits from banks. So what the government is doing is to encourage development of credit institutions, apart from the commercial banks. Agricultural Bank of South Sudan is established. And now soon, maybe in the next 2 weeks, we are going to open the Cooperative Bank of South Sudan, which was which is a public-private partnership between the government of South Sudan and the Cooperative Bank of Kenya. And the idea is that it will sell off shares of the government of South Sudan to the public asset go-alongs from the third year on, so that in the seventh year it is totally owned by the people, the cooperators, and the Cooperative Bank of Kenya. Developing of microcredit institutions like SUMI for the small grassroots farmers, that there is a place that they can go and borrow little money, that they can move their little production and can pay back without a lot of hurdles. So this also needs policy that does not have does not ask these farmers to produce collaterals, but can enhance them to borrow little and pay back in good time. But all this would not work very well in the long run if we don't have a very strong research and extension services. Because for farmers, you need to move the information to them, you need to collect information from them, you need very good extension services. But we need research that can tell us that we can develop seeds locally, or we can buy improved seeds. We need research that give information to farmers, that move agriculture of the country, that does not depend totally on imported ideas. There are four key ministries that are working in this. Ministry of Agriculture is the lead, but we have Ministry of Roads and Bridges. As I said before, you cannot improve productivity and then you stop there, unless you move it beyond the farm gate, move it to the market. So Ministry of Roads and Bridges is very crucial to this strategy. Their mandate is to plan, develop, and maintain the critical road and bridges transport infrastructure for South Sudan. Then we have the Minister of Animal Resources. I said before, South Sudan is the sixth largest base for livestock keeping in Africa. Its mandate is to promote, regulate, and facilitate animal production, fisheries, value addition, and access to markets, and overall coordination and provision of policy and regulation framework aimed at creating conducive environment for livestock and fishery sector growth and investment in the country. Then we have the Ministry of Water, because it's standing alone as a ministry, Ministry of Water Resources and Irrigation. If we are to move agriculture, rain-fed agriculture is good, but it's not good enough because it's not reliable. It's depending on what God gives us. So since God also gave us the water, we need to use it. Although if there's an Egyptian in this room, he will tell me, don't touch that water because that's our life. But it's the life of South Sudan too. So we need to touch the water. We need to use the water. We need to irrigate so that we increase productivity and improve productivity in South Sudan. That's why we have a whole ministry of water resource and irrigation. Boosting investment in agriculture means creating an enabling environment. The sector-specific policy frameworks, which has just been passed recently, it has given the South directions. So from that, now they are developing very the sector policies from the framework. Central emphasis of this policy is on creating a clear and consistent policy and regulatory environment for investment and investors in agriculture sector. The policy frameworks also emphasize on public investments to improve rural infrastructure, such as feeder roads and improved agricultural extension. While roads are very expensive to build, and sometimes people say, no, that's the role of the government, but we also need private investment in feeder roads so that it supports the development effort of the government. Investment facilitation, such as the South Sudan Investment Authority, has been created, as I said before. This is to ease investment in the country. And then systems are being developed to facilitate rapid business setup, for example, a one-stop shop. I think now you can register your business in South Sudan maybe in 24 to 72 hours. It initially took months. When we first started in 2005, it would go 6 months. It reduced to 4 months, to 1 month. Now you can do it 24 hours. This one-stop shop, you can ask all your questions and fill all the forms in one room. And members of the investment authority, the board are composed of the line ministries that are responsible for the various investments. But the secretary general of the board is a very high caliber position that can have access to the ministers or even to the president at any time if there's something that needs sorting. So it helps a lot to move decisions on investment for those who want to set up investment in South Sudan. We are also establishing the agricultural trade fairs now on a yearly basis. We did it last year, and the recommendation we got was that it's so good because it brings together investors. It also brings farmers of South Sudan together. The farmers sit together and they talk among themselves and ask questions, how did you do it in your state? And then investors also have the opportunity to talk to farmers, but investors also have the opportunities to talk among themselves as investors and also to talk to government. So this year, we are hosting it again in November. It will be the 27th to the 30th. I would like to extend invitation to all of you who are here to come to the trade fair in Juba, 27th to the 30th. You have 3 weeks. You can still go. The ambassadors and the officials of the Embassy of the Republic of South Sudan are here. The embassy is not far away from this building. They can facilitate your visa to go to South Sudan. So please come and see for yourself if you're not going to be a participant in the trade fair. I encourage you to come to South Sudan. What are the areas of possible partnership that we are looking for? We are looking for partnership in capacity building. We are looking for people that can support us and help us build our capacity. To build and rehabilitate the national research institutions, we used to have research institutions. Now we are trying to reactivate it, but it needs not only human capacity, but it also needs other infrastructural capacity so that it can be rehabilitated. We are also looking for capacity building to develop rural infrastructure, especially feeder roads and storage capacity. We are looking to strengthen and create rural institutions, for example, agricultural extensions and credit facilities. We are also looking for farmers' field schools so that we can use it as a demonstration areas or even mini researches for the farmers' field school. The human capital investment is very important. We're looking for bilateral and multilateral donor support to build our human capital. And we are also looking for analytical support, identify systematic constraint to agricultural development. If we can identify, document it systematically, it means we can begin to say, let's tick off this, what can we solve one at a time, and who can help us do this one. In concluding remarks, I'm saying the Republic of South Sudan is very committed to transform agriculture. It's a new country, but it needs to feed its people because you cannot be a baby and you don't suckle milk. So the Republic of South Sudan is very committed to transform agriculture, but it needs cooperation and partnership with the international development and institutions, donors for immediate short-term strategy, but also medium and long-term strategy. For example, research is a medium to long-term. And without it, our long-term will be blur. So we need this medium to long-term as well as the short-term strategy. Partnership and support is critical for attracting investments building institutional and human capacity, as well as developing and implementing the national growth strategy. We want to seek support in strengthening our research capacity as a long-term strategy for developing agriculture. Help South Sudan find a new path, one that relies more on renewable sectors like agriculture than on its exhaustible resource, oil. The oil of South Sudan has turned out to be a curse rather than a wealth. So we are saying, yes, the oil money would be there, but we want to use the oil money to develop sectors like agriculture, because this one, it can continue and will live forever as long as we have the soil. But the oil can get exhausted. But also there is a lot of fight over the oil of South Sudan. So if we can keep it minimum and we boost up the agriculture to boost production and the economy, the gross domestic product, that is what we are looking for. And thank you very much for listening.